Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Surviving Scientology Radio with your host, Jeffrey Augustine. Today we have on with us a special guest, Robert Dam. Robert, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Jeffrey.
Robert, you are the author of a very intriguing book, The Defector, after 25 years in Scientology. Outstanding book. What led you to write it?
Well, first, thank you very much, Jeffrey. That's kind words. Let's just have a look what actually happened. What happened was that I posted my website like at the same time I was defecting or leaving the church. I posted a fairly substantial website about it, and that was up there for perhaps a year or so, until one Danish newspaper picked it up. They wanted to write something on Scientology, and they found my website and they contacted me for an interview. And I went there and did the interview, and they were quite amazed by it, and they made a front page article out of it and so on. And then the other newspapers picked it up, and they also wanted interviews, even though for me at that point it was not any more new, but for them it was all new. And one of the bigger newspapers in Denmark, the reporter there, he said that he thought it was really well written, my things. There was a lot of it he didn't understand because it was written for Scientologists or ex-Scientologists. So there were some terms and stuff he did, but he grasped the idea and he thought it was so amazing. He read the whole thing. So he said, if you ever consider writing a book, I think you should, because your story is important. It's exciting. It's and he said, you're a good writer, so go for it. If you find the time, if you find the spirit to do it, then go for it. And he said he knew one of the directors at one of the major publishing houses, and he would be happy to make the connection. So that's basically how it started. I thought, well, okay, if anybody else can benefit from it, and then also I like writing, so I thought, well, that could be fun. Not that I had the time for it, I started like when I went to bed in the evenings. I took my little laptop and just started writing until I fell asleep, and then. And then I got into it that way, and the publishing house was really—they were intrigued, and they thought it was well written and exciting, and they wanted to do it. So that's basically how it started.
Well, I'm glad you undertook the project. I remember reading your website in 2004 when you defected, and I was intrigued. Now, because a couple of reasons. One, you were not an American, and I was very curious about the experience of Scientology for Europeans, for Colombians, people outside the US. Because in some ways it's different. I worked for Siemens for many years and also for Philips. So I worked for two large European multinational firms. And I came to appreciate the cultural and intellectual differences between Europeans and Americans, and also people from Latin America, other parts of the world, New Zealand, and Scientology, I think, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but Scientology being an authoritarian organization seems to translate into Europe just like it does in America. Would you say that the culture of Scientology transcends boundaries and is the same across the world? Did you find that to be true?
That is my experience, yes, absolutely. I mean, there's nothing Danish or European over the Scientology culture. That it is very different, and it's also considered that way. I mean, everything is different about it. I mean, they look different, they walk different, the whole thing. It's very un-Danish and very un-European, as I find. So I think you're right. I mean, when I've been traveling to different Scientology orgs, I find that's a very distinct culture of its own.
So really, you as a Scientologist, you who attain the level of OT5, you could travel anywhere in the Scientology world across the globe, and you would have a uniform experience. I'm not saying it's a good experience, but you would know what to expect.
Yeah, exactly. You know how to speak to people, how to joke, how to do this and that. I mean, yeah, that you're very right in that.
Yeah, and also how to keep your guard up.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah. Well, you know what? Let's start where you were born in 1964 in Denmark. And as a young man, you write in your book that you wanted to be a musician. You were very idealistic. You were living what we call in America a very hand-to-mouth existence. You were just getting by.
Sure.
As was I when I was in college. I know what it's like to be young and broke. And but to have goals and aspirations and dreams. So you were attracted to Scientology as a young man. And what was that initial attraction or that experience that got you in?
It's quite funny. I don't remember if I wrote about it in my book, but when I moved to Copenhagen, I lived in another city of Denmark, the third biggest city. But I moved to Copenhagen as a 19 years old guy, and lived in an apartment that one of my parents' friends, she had that apartment, and she was away, so I could use it. I lived there with my brother. We could use it for like half a year or a year or something like that. So we stayed there in the beginning, and she was the type of person who would stick all the postcards that she would be getting. She would stick them on the toilet wall. So she had a toilet, a tiny little toilet, because this was downtown Copenhagen in one of the not the rich area, but like a little bit of the poor area of Copenhagen downtown, and very small apartments, very small toilets. And she had the whole toilet plastered with postcards from all over the world. And there was one specific that caught my attention. Whenever I went to have a pee, I would look at that only postcard. It was blue, not very nice. It was cyan blue, and it was written with pink or magenta. Pink letters was written Dianetics, and then there was this drawing. This is like hand drawn artwork of a volcano. And it said Dianetics, and I just looked at that postcard saying, what the hell is Dianetics? And it just puzzled me. And then one day I was walking in the western area of the Copenhagen city, and this lady, young lady, asked me if she could ask me a question. She approached me on the street, and that turned out to be a bodybuilder. And I looked at the she was standing in front of some kind of shop, and I looked at the big shop sign there, and it said Dianetics. And in the window, there was a big poster of a volcano. So I thought, wow, what the hell, here we are. So now I get my question answered. So I followed her just to see what the hell it was. And that's basically how the whole thing started. She wanted me to do an OCA test. So I filled out those 200 questions. I spent hours on it. I thought it was quite funny. So I spent hours on filling out these questions, and in the evening I went back to have my results, and basically that was where it started.
Now, so you were approached by a body router on the street, and then you took what's called the Oxford Capacity Analysis Test, the 200 question test, and it asked you know, strange questions. Do you study train schedules? You know, train timetables, which is, you know, I remember when I took it, it also, as a young man, one of my clients recommended I investigate Scientology. And that was the first thing I did, was to take this test. And I remember some of the questions stood out as odd, because I had taken different tests in university and in the course of my employment, certainly, but nothing like this. So what were your results? Were you did your results show that you were awful shape and condition, or what did they give you as your results?
Basically, the message was that I was a perfectionist, an introvert, and a perfectionist, and basically everything he said was true. that I was my communication was low, my criticism was high, I was stable, but I was unhappy. I mean, all these things. No wonder. I mean, I answered the 200 questions, so of course it would be. But it strikes me as being incredibly spot on. So I denied everything. I said no, that's not true. No, that's not true. But he kind of looked right through me, and it was very, to me, very convincing.
So then you joined Scientology, and you write in your book that you were resisting what this fellow was telling you. Was it Heinrich? Was that the name?
No, his name was Jan Hansen.
Okay, Jan, yeah.
And he was a type of guy, like really high altitude, really, and he was like maybe 15 years older than I, and he was like charismatic guy, and I felt like I was completely undressed, and he would just look right through me, and that's what he did. And he, I mean, all the points he made, he started making some points about my good sides, you know, like that I was a very dedicated, that I was very ambitious, and so on. I had this good sense of detail and all these kind of things. And then he started going into why are you unhappy? And why are you introverted? You don't find it easy to meet new people and to make friends and so on. And basically the whole thing was incredibly convincing. And then he said after that, he said, well, but we have some very simple tools to fix all that. It's not, we see it every day. It's not a problem. I mean, you would think it's a problem, but we can fix this quite easily, actually. So, and he asked me for some ridiculously small amount for a 10 hours introductory therapy, Dianetics, it turned out to be. And I was thrilled, I was enthused, I couldn't believe, I mean, it was so convincing that I was totally convinced that this would turn around my life for the better. And I also knew, somewhere in my consciousness, I knew that I needed some kind of personal boost in order to fulfill my ambition of becoming a professional musician. I mean, it would take some special, not only being a skilled drummer or something, but I would need some on a personal level, some kind of boost, something to make me more extrovert, to make it easier for me to communicate to people and make friends and find my way into the right circles. Because being a professional musician in such a small country, I mean, that is incredibly hard. So, and there's so few people here who can actually make a living out of that. And I knew all that, so I thought, basically, I denied it, but I knew in deep down in my consciousness, I knew that I really needed some kind of personal boost to make me special in order to make it. And I was convinced that I just met it. So for me, the decision was easy. I just wanted to try this out. And I came back with the money some days or weeks after and paid. It was a very low amount. I don't remember what it was. It was not much. And I paid for this 10 hours introductory package, and that's where I got my first experience with Dianetics.
You know, that's interesting. Let's take apart the elements for new Scientology watchers. They always ask how could people get pulled into Scientology, but let's look at Robert's initial introduction. It's very seductive. It's very seductive. You have, you take a test that seems to be scientific if you didn't know better. And then you have someone with a high degree of confidence, maybe some insight from Scientology. And basically they're going to very skillfully work with you and find some area where you're vulnerable or you need help. And really the outcome of this initial interview is to say that we have answers for you. We can help. And I'll share something, Robert, I don't normally share. But one reason I went to investigate Scientology is I wanted to explore the topic of past lives. You joined staff in Copenhagen shortly after you entered Scientology?
Yes, that was back in the spring 84. So I just turned 20. And basically after the 10 hours of introductory Dianetics auditing, I was convinced. I must say, I don't remember. I only remember the first session. I don't remember anything after the other session. It's quite funny. But the first session was amazing. It was incredible. I mean, the whole thing. I had bought a copy of the book Dianetics, but I hadn't read it all. I had read maybe a few chapters and so on. So I didn't know so much about it, but it was quite amazing. I mean, the incidents that he ran, and it became vivid. I mean, it was almost like being there again. I could hear, I could see, I could sense, I could smell, all the perception turned on, and the whole thing just ran. I mean, for my auditor, it must have been a nice, like, totally out of the book case, because I see afterwards when I read the book that this was what was supposed to happen. But all that happened, and it was basically, I was just turned 20, and I had some girlfriend who dumped me when I was 15, long, long back, and a long forgotten. But that was when he asked for a loss, that was one that came up. And it became incredibly alive, and he blew the incident. I mean, he ran it through until it erased. And I couldn't help laughing. I was just laughing, laughing. And I thought, you know, I've been such a fool. Imagine that I've been actually holding on to that loss for 5 years, and it's been holding me down. It's ridiculous. I've been such a fool. The world is full of young women. I mean, what's the problem? So I was just like walking out of there laughing aloud. And when I walked home, I was hardly touching the sidewalk, because I remember I was so uplifted. It was really, really a kick. So that was the session that I'll never forget. But what happened in the remaining, because it was just one session, first one, what happened in the remaining ones, I can't remember any of it. So it couldn't have been that spectacular, but the first session was enough to like convince me that this is it. I have found it, you know?
Yes, sir.
So when,
One of your first jobs in Scientology was being a body router. So could you tell our audience, we have a lot of new Scientology watchers, what is a Scientology body router? What does the term mean, and what is your job as a body router?
A Scientology body router is just as a street salesman, basically. You go on the street, pick up people, and bring them into the shop, which is typically made into a kind of test center, looking a little scientific, and having information about this personality test. What the one they call the Oxford Capacity Analysis, and it's basically a test that has 200 questions and is supposed to find out who you are. I mean, where's your strong sides? Where are your weak sides, and so on, to draw a profile of your personality. And a body router is just a guy who stands on the street, inviting people in. We don't know it from. I mean, here in Denmark, nobody uses that. But if you travel down to the Mediterranean, down to Southern Europe, you would see all the restaurants. We typically have one of the waiters would be standing on the street and inviting people in and telling them that we just got a nice lamb or whatever, and try to fill up the restaurant that way. So down there at the Mediterranean area, they use it commonly. But here in Northern Europe, it's we don't use that at all. So that was quite different, you know, somebody standing in the street asking people, just bypassers, to come in. There are some organizations like Greenpeace or other humanitarian organizations. They would sometimes go in the street, and but that would not be to invite people into a specific shop. It would be to ask them questions or to make them join Greenpeace or something else. But at that time, when I started, that was back in 84, there was hardly any of that. I think they call them facers today, isn't it? I think that's a new phrase, facers, like a guy who stands face to face with you.
Oh, I don't know. We here, two things. When I was young and in the Christian church, I had to do Christian ministry, which was to go out onto the streets and what we call witness, testify about Jesus Christ and hand out literature, invite people to the church, that kind of thing. So I can identify with body routers. to my knowledge, here in Hollywood, my wife Karen and I live just 5 minutes away from the Celebrity Center, and 5 minutes away from the pack base, Big Blue. And they still call them body routers. When I go to my bank, which is by the org, I will sometimes walk over for a Starbucks and then maybe walk over and see the body routers. And you can watch them. I often get approached, although I am an SP, not all body routers know me, right? So sometimes I'll just listen to see what they're pitching. Because I am in sales, and I have been in sales for a very long time. So I look at this as a sales process. Because it is a transaction. And body routing, by the way, is sort of always a term that I find to be creepy or disturbing, because it's literally taking a body, routing it into an org. And
True.
I don't want, but anyway, I it's yeah. So the body routers here are still called body routers. Now,
No, they are here too. It's just the common name for it, like not Scientology, but just an ordinary name for it when people go on the street, like for UNICEF or for Greenpeace, whatever. These people are called facers these days
Oh,
because they
okay.
go out there and face people they don't know and so on.
Oh, I hadn't heard the term. That's very interesting. We would call them solicitors here, and usually here in America, around political elections, you get a lot of people on the streets who are paid each day to go out with clipboards and get petitions signed or get out the vote. So
Yeah,
they're
we
the
see that too
solicitors.
around elections. Yes, that's right.
And then, of course, in Las Vegas, when you go, there's all kinds of people on the street selling all kinds of stuff. And but so you're a body router. Did you find that there was a lot of rejection, or was there acceptance, or were you successful as a body router?
I was to some sometimes I was. I mean, in the beginning, it was not easy because we were. The Church of Scientology, Denmark was and still is lying in the middle of Copenhagen. So there's a lot of people working there, and there's a lot of people living there. I mean, on the upper floors of the buildings would be apartments. So there was a lot of people passing by every morning because they needed to go to work. And I didn't know that in the beginning, so I approached everyone, and they got really severely pissed off with me because they didn't want that every morning when they went on work. So I had to start knowing the faces and know who to not approach. But even though there was a lot of rejection, I mean, people sometimes I was threatened with being beaten up, and they would some guys would push me up against the wall or against the window, or they would try to beat me, and so it was a little bit wild. But you know what? It for me, I think this was a good drill. Really, for me, it was a good drill because I was a bit of an introvert. What Jan Hansen told me at the test evaluation was true. I mean, I was not for me, it was not easy to go and approach people I didn't know. So this was a good drill. I mean, I think I was body routing for maybe, I don't remember, 3 to 5 months or something before I was transferred to another department. And
Sure, I can see how it would build confidence. I mean, what?
it did help me a lot. Yes, it was also a hard job. I mean, it was hard because people generally was really negative and against you, and there was a lot of hate, and there was a lot of swear words, and so it was tough. Sometimes though, I would have a good day, like an upstat where my statistic would be up, because my statistic was NPI. It was called new people in. As simple as that. Just a simple count of how many new people I would get into the shop. No matter how long or short they were in there, as long as they stepped over the door and into the shop, they would count on my statistic. And there was a Chinese restaurant just on the other side of the street, and sometimes a bus full of Chinese tourists would come in order to eat at that restaurant. So if I was lucky, I would be able to shout over there and say, hey, it's this way, this way, this way. And they would come, if I get the attention of the leader, they would come walk over the street and come this way, because just because I directed them to do so. That was actually body rotting, almost, because it's just because I said, told them to with a loud voice, it's here. Yes, it's here, I would say. They would come in like 30 or 40 tourists would walk into the shop and find out it was not there, and they would leave again. But they would all count on my statistics, and that would be an upset day.
Sure. Robert, I have to tell you a very funny story here. In Hollywood, the HGB building, it's on Hollywood Boulevard in Ivar. It's where, it's where, Office of Special Affairs is on the 10th and 11th floor, right? But the the ground floor of the HGB is the L. Ron Hubbard Lifetime Museum.
Yeah.
And it has a lot of e-meters and things from when Ron Hubbard was a boy, and, it sort of pictures and goes through his life story, right? Now, what's really funny is it is admission is free to the L. Ron Hubbard Lifetime Museum. And so tour operators who bring in people from China or other places, because it's free, you see these buses pull up with Chinese tourists, and they're being piled into the L. Ron Hubbard Museum, and they don't have any idea who L. Ron Hubbard is or what they're doing. Because in communist China or Hong Kong, you really don't, know about Scientology. But because it's free, the tour operators just snag it along with some other free stuff, right? To kind of pad out the time. So I imagine, the stats are pretty good at the HGB on the same basis.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, so let's fast forward. Here's what I really, really found interesting in your book. You begin business with a fellow Scientologist in the printing business. So let's fast forward. So you're printing magazines and books for Scientology Europe.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah,
and I am fast forwarding. And if you want the details, you have to read Robert's book. It's available on Amazon. But so suddenly you're a businessman, and you're a print broker.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Now this is an amazing story of how things can go wrong in Scientology. Mm-hmm. So, what do you? I think you gave a number like 170,000 magazines total across Europe, like the mailing list of 170,000, if I recall.
There were two mailing lists. One that was called Major. That means for everyone who's ever taken a course.
Yeah.
In Scientology, whatever course, and that was 72 or 74,000 names on that list, and there was a minor list, and minor list was anybody who had ever bought a book or made a test or by in some way delivered their name and address to somewhere in the church. So that was called the minor list, people who has only been on minor services, so to speak, but they hadn't even had to have been on any service. Just if they'd given you their name to the church, they would be on the minor list. And that was about 100 and it started out being 180, and then it came down to 150,000 names. So it's still quite a substantial print job.
So you were making a good income. Mm-hmm. By that time, you were married and had a nice place to live.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're printing. Now this gets. I'm going to tell part of the story, and you can fill in the blanks.
Mm-hmm.
So you're trying to save Scientology in Europe hundreds of thousands of dollars in postage, because it's expensive to mail that much mail.
Yeah.
So tell the audience your solution and what happened. This is a great part of the book.
I mean, even though we were Scientologists and the church preferred to work with Scientologists because they could bully them around easier. I mean, they would call us like Sunday afternoon and demand we were in there for a meeting Sunday night or whatever, and we would show up, So because we were Scientologists, we were much, much easier for them to work with. And we would be, as Scientologists, we would be publics. So we would be low on the command channels. We'd have to show up to whatever they ordered us to do. but we were also a contractor, as a supplier.
Yes, supplier.
So we would have to compete with the other companies. We didn't get more, we didn't get a higher price for the print jobs we did for the church. we would just get the jobs, but we'd have to compete. They would, in turn, they would help us. Look, they would hint us and say the other guys is charging 39,000 for this job, and or they would show us the quotes from the other guys. So they would just help us to find the right price level, and sure, we would have to be cheaper. I mean, they didn't want to pay any more, even though they could bully us around as they pleased. So we went in there and were competitive, and we would land the jobs. And it started with smaller jobs, and we ended up printing all their magazines and printing basically everything for the church in here in Copenhagen. And that's a lot, because Copenhagen, Scientology in Copenhagen, is the European headquarters. They also have the publishing house called New Era Publications, and they do all Hubbard's translated materials, not only into Danish, but to all of the world. I mean, in US you do all the American, all the English language stuff,
yes,
but for all the foreign languages, it's all being made here in Copenhagen. So there was a big publishing house called New Era Publications, and we printed for them also. Later on, they got their own print equipment and so on, but at that time we had a lot of business from the church. And the two magazines we were publishing that would go out to all the publics, those ones we managed to land also, and but we were constantly challenged on price. So at some point I found out that the big expense was not so much our printing expense, that was also a big expense, but the bigger expense was the postage. To send this out through the Danish post office was ridiculously expensive. So I thought, well, if I can do something on the postage, I would have an even better grab of the customer, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I went out to explore, and I found out that in the Far East, we could print slightly cheaper than at our own printing plant, and we could post it a lot cheaper. So I suggested it to the church that I can save them a lot of money. It would mean that I would print it out in the Far East, and I gave them some quotes, and they were like thrilled. They were really happy about this. They thought it was brilliant, and they went with it. And at a later point, after 2 years' time, I think 2 or 3 years, I found out we could do it even cheaper out of Africa. So they went with that too. But the African print plants, they were like really lousy, really old technology, and they couldn't turn out any quality. So I had to stay by the press every time we did a print job, and direct the press operators and tell them what to do and approve everything that came out of the press, because they were not up to the standards that the church wanted. But I managed somehow to get a decent standard out of it that the church could live with. And they would be saving like millions almost, I don't know, in US dollars, but it was huge sums of money they would be saving on this. So I was a star. I mean, I became a star at the management level. They would say, I mean, it's not, they wouldn't receive me with a red carpet, but almost. So because they were saving so much money, so now they could send out all the magazines. Usually they would not be able to send out the scheduled amount of numbers because they wouldn't have money for it. Now, all of a sudden, they could meet their publishing schedules and actually send out a magazine every second month and the other one every month and so on. They could do that now because they had the money to do it.
Yeah, and that's
so it was in a way, for me as a supplier or contractor, it was a great success, because they would never now think of changing to one of my competitors. It was in a way, for me as a supplier or contractor, it was a great success, because they would never now think of changing to one of my competitors. I mean, the competitors was totally, there was no way they could beat me on this. So I thought I did quite well. And also as a Scientologist, I helped my community, so to speak, to save money and to get more magazines out and so on. So it was a win-win situation.
Sure. Thinking outside the box as you did, saving the organization, say, upwards of $1 million, of course you would be viewed in very favorable terms.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as you're right, one day there's a knock on the door from Sea Org members. The postage goes wrong. What happened? How did the postage go wrong?
It's actually a little bit of an interesting story, because why would Africa be able to send mail into Denmark and into Europe, because the church was sending to all the European countries, I think the biggest amount was Italy and France, and there was a lot in, there was something in England, and there was a lot in Germany, and something to Denmark. It was basically spread all over Europe. And how can an African country send post into these countries so much cheaper than you can do from here, and from any European post office? And it turned out to be some kind of arrangement that the European Union has made with these African countries, because they give them a special discount, they give them a special rate, because otherwise no African would be able to afford sending a letter to Europe. So they had some special arrangements that meant that from Africa, the postage was like a tenth of what it was here in Europe.
So
basically the arrangement that we exploited by sending the mail from Africa. I also produced the whole thing in Africa, so we were not doing anything illegal. It was not remail. Remail would have been if I produced and printed the whole thing in Europe and shipped it down to Africa just to ship it back to Europe. That would be considered remail, and that would not be allowed. But we were actually printing and producing in Africa, and that's what they wanted. They wanted business for the country. So they were also happy. I mean, they would know when I came to the airport in Zimbabwe, and they would come there with a big Mercedes to pick me up and to dine me and to do this and that, because they were really happy with this.
Wow.
I mean, this was the biggest export customer in all of Zimbabwe. That was me and the church. That was the biggest export in the printing, not in the other industries.
Sure,
they had a lot. This was the biggest export job. So they would treat me like a VIP. And they were really happy with the whole thing. The German post office, on the other hand, they were not thrilled. Because they started, when we did this first, the Zimbabwean post office had an agreement with Frankfurt to send all the mails through Frankfurt airport and filtered in through the post terminal there, and from there distributed to Europe. That was the arrangement the whole Zimbabwean post office had with Europe. And they picked it up, of course. The Germans said, what is this Scientology doing? Bags and bags and hundreds of bags of Scientology mail. That is not initiated. It's not originated from Zimbabwe. And that was true. So they basically stored it. And we ended up having, and I didn't know about that until later. I mean, I've been printing this, doing this routine for maybe a year. So there was a lot of magazines. A lot of it came out. I mean, but at some point, they spotted it. And they didn't pick out every mailbag with signs on, but they pick up a lot of them and put them aside. And I came to know about that because the Frankfurt terminal people would contact the Zimbabwean post office and they would tell me. They were quite upfront about it. So when I found out, that is a major problem, because if all the stuff that I've been charging my clients for doing is sitting at the at the post terminal somewhere, that is critical. I mean, this was a major thing. So I went down there to the Zimbabweans, and I managed to get a meeting with one of the top postmaster general guy down there. I mean, even though there were like 3,000 people there, I managed to get to the top and have a meeting in the boardroom meeting room. And these guys took it really, really serious. And I basically said to them that they had to find some other European country and to mail it in through some other channel and to pick up all the hundreds of mailbags that went stuck in Frankfurt, to pick them up, fly them back, and send them through the new line. The chances of success, I mean, was hardly there, but they agreed. So they went to Schiphol, in the airport in Amsterdam in Holland.
Yeah, yes, I've been there.
And they invited me to participate in a meeting there. I mean, so I was a big shot, because this was a lot of business for the country, for the Zimbabwean country. They didn't want to lose it, so they sent one of their executives from the post office to Holland. And in Holland they were thrilled. They would like to get, I mean, because they would be, there is some kind of agreement between the post office, so they would get money for it, for the in the actual sorting center. They would view it as any other job. So they were quite happy doing it. And we made signed a contract. I was actually there at the meeting where the Zimbabwean post executive signed the contract with the post terminal in Schiphol Airport. And then they started sending out through Schiphol, and everything went fine again. And Zimbabwean post office even paid for picking up all the hundreds of post bags in Frankfurt, shipping them back to Zimbabwe and back to Schiphol to be distributed. So it was quite amazing to manage to influence on such a high level and to change the whole way a country sends in mail to Europe. It was quite unique, actually.
Certainly.
So I felt fairly proud about myself, I must admit. I thought I had made quite a spectacular move. But from the church mentality, things were viewed quite differently.
So basically, the European Union had given Africa humanitarian rates very low, and then you were taking advantage of it, which is not illegal. But then the Germans didn't want to pay to deliver at a reduced rate, but the Dutch were happy to.
Yeah.
Now that's a good solution. You know, just as one business person to another, that's a very good solution. However, it didn't go right in the mind of the Church of Scientology. For what reason?
Basically, because the income of the Scientology headquarters in Europe was down. Mm. It has crashed. It had crashed. And new members, they didn't get any new members. I could see from my position, I was printing and mailing these magazines, I could see the quantities were going down. So whenever I turned up at some celebration or big event where they were telling that we were getting more and more members, I would know that they were lying. I mean, I would have known that for a long time. Because I was sitting, I could see the quantities of these magazines was going down. So of course we were not getting new members. We were being fewer and fewer. but everybody else was clapping and applauding and thought it was fantastic, all the expansion. But I knew that it was not true. I didn't say that to anybody, of course.
I was
applauding along with the rest of them. But I knew it was a lie.
But Robert, you know that you're the guy who knows how many magazines they're shipping, mailing out. And so you see the church membership decreasing. So as a function of that membership decrease, their income would naturally go down.
Exactly.
But you have to play along and applaud, even though you know it's a lie, because that's just expected. And management of Scientology has always lied about membership numbers. Just as surely as the sun rises, they're going to lie about expansion. So they're instead of saying, like, what do we do to grow the business? What are our real problems? How do we solve this problem? They basically blame it on you.
Yeah.
They blame the entire, what Scientology calls a stat crash, on you.
That was what happened, yes.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Because they said, you know what, we've been sending out these magazines and some people hasn't received the magazines. I told them about this whole thing, what happened and how I solved it, and I was pretty proud of myself. But they for some reason, I mean, the local management, they dug it. They said, "Well, fantastic, Robert. This is totally OT. This is fantastic." And they were over the moon, but they couldn't convey that to international management. And it came from Miscavige and his people over there. They just wanted somebody to blame, and it was not going well in Europe. The income was down, new members was down, everything was down, and it was like he had fixed his mind on this thing that they had been cheated by somebody from the outside, like somebody like me, who is not in the C organization, but working like a contractor, working for the C organization, and they had been cheated, and he was like, he was totally fixed on that. He couldn't. I supplied receipts from post offices. I supplied all kind of documentation to prove that what I had told them was the truth and nothing but the truth. But it didn't work. I mean, they would just say that I had falsified, and
sure.
I bribed somebody to falsify these documents. And so there's nothing I could do. There was nothing I could do. They just wanted a scapegoat, and that was me. So basically, what they said was that I had been cheating and embezzling money from the church by not printing and sending everything that I claimed I had. I mean, all the receipts, all the proof I could produce was all fake. I got that from bribing people, and that I've been basically stealing from the church, like millions of dollars. So I just had to confess. Basically, my only choice was to confess or be kicked out. And if I confessed to something I hadn't done, I would be kicked out anyway. So it was not a very good situation. So I refused to confess and said, I'm sorry, I have my documentation, I have my evidence. You can even go down there and speak to people. You can ask them. I will give you all the names of the executives from the Zimbabwean Post, from the Dutch Post. I will give you everything. I mean, there's nothing. There's nothing to come after here. I mean, but it didn't help. They wanted a confession, no matter what.
Now, you had to go to FLAG, and you were sec-checked extensively for a crime you did not commit, something you didn't do. But what I found interesting in your book, Robert, is you were sec-checked by the then Inspector General Religious Technology Center, Marty Rathbun.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you were sec-checked by Marty Rathbun, was this an intimidating experience? What was your experience of Marty as the Inspector General?
I mean, he was he was really intimidating. I mean, I was frightened not only by Marty, also by his men, but Marty was the worst. I mean, he was the type of guy that you just know you do what he say. I mean, there's no way around it. There's no other way to go. I mean, if he asks you something, you answer, and if he tells you to do something, you do it. I mean, no matter what it is. That's the type of guy he was. And we have some pretty creepy guys here in Europe, like the top chief, Walter Kotrick. I don't know if he's still around, but at that time, and he is really a Nazi officer by look and by appearance, and really creepy. But I mean, Marty Rathbun, I mean, nobody was anything in comparison to Marty Rathbun. I feared that guy with all of my body and soul. I'm telling you, he was totally frightening. And he was not even wearing a SEAL uniform. The first day I met him, he had a civil, just an ordinary suit. Brown, steel brown kind of colors suit, and he had like several people running around him all the time in SEAL uniform, and he would tell them to do this and to do that and so on, and they would just, yes sir, yes sir. So probably was his CMO, it was young people, probably it was his CMO guys servicing him, but looking in his eyes, like he had like, how can I explain it? When I looked in his eyes, I was nobody. Mm-hmm. I was just some trouble item that he had to sort out as quick as possible, and I should do as little resistance and make as little problems for him as I could, because otherwise it would be worse for me. So that was the way I felt, that this guy, I just have to do everything he says, otherwise it would be a nightmare, and he can make my life a living hell. And I was also, in the back of my mind, I was fearing how long he could make me stay over there, because I'd given my passport. When I turned into the hotel for Fort Harrison, they asked for my passport, and I willingly gave it to them. So I didn't have my passport, and I knew the Scientology hierarchy, the way the organization is built, and this guy was like the second in command, just under David Miscavige. So if he didn't want me to have my passport, I wouldn't get it, for sure.
Yeah, and that's really
so that
something.
was in the back of my mind. I didn't know the horizon. I mean, how long time would I have to be in the US? I know I didn't have a job, because if he didn't want me to have my passport, I wouldn't get it for sure. I didn't know the horizon. I mean, how long time would I have to be in the US? I know I didn't have a job, because the church would never engage me for printing again, since they blamed me of being the whole reason for Europe, the whole of Europe being downstaffed or being not doing well. That's for sure. They would never ever engage me in any print jobs again. And that part of my business had become my main business. I mean, working for the church, I didn't have time for any of my other clients. And I also made a fairly good income. I mean, I didn't become rich, but I made fairly well from the business. So basically, other clients was maybe 5% of my business. So that was nothing. So I'd have to find out how to find a job, find out how to make a living, how to pay my house rent, how to pay food for my wife and my little kid. And now I was in the US, I couldn't do anything. And we had no money. There was no money at all. I couldn't pay my house rent, couldn't pay my car, couldn't pay food, couldn't pay anything. And my wife was still on maternity leave with, we had a little kid. It was just coming to an end, but she was not back in work yet. So she had no money. So it was all on me. And I was sitting there in Florida for God knows how long.
Yeah, that is, and you're describing a situation that's all too typical in the Church of Scientology. A Scientologist becomes dependent upon their fellow Scientologists or the Church for their income, and all of your friends and family are in the Church, so if you don't confess, you could lose everything. You could be declared a suppressive person, you'll lose all your business, friends, family, and I mean, you're out on the street. Robert, I just wanted to add a technical point for New Time Scientology listeners. L. Ron Hubbard said that when you mail out Scientology promotional literature, in about 6 weeks, the statistics should go up.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, because the German post office slowed down the mail flow of the things you were publishing or printing and delivering, the mail didn't go out in a timely manner. Therefore, within Hubbard's logic, you were to blame because the mail didn't go out in time.
Yeah.
And now this is arbitrary, and it doesn't coordinate with the reality that 6 weeks after you mail out something, you'll get more business. That's just not the way it works. On direct mail campaigns, you maybe get a 1% return. That's a number that's generally been used in the old days when direct mail was used, before the advent of the internet. So you're stuck, and you wind up agreeing to just get out home, to get your passport back and get home, that there was an Italian issue that had muddy photographs and maybe should have been reprinted. That is, you gave them something.
Yeah, basically I made up various things I could admit to. I mean, it was like, it occurred to me that they had to have something. I mean, they would never let me go home without having me admitted to something. So if I confessed to the charges they were putting on me, I would be kicked out. I would be declared a suppressive person and kicked out of Scientology. I would lose my friends, my family, everything. So I couldn't do that. And also, they could basically jail me almost for it, because it was criminal. It was so much money. It was criminal. They could make a...
Oh, they could make your life a nightmare.
The charges. So I couldn't confess to that. It was not an option. So I had to find something else. So I thought, okay, I'll just find whatever else I've done and confess to all of it, just to give them something to satisfy their bloodthirst. So that's what I did. I figured out that at some point there was an Italian magazine where there was a little dot in somebody's face, some happy, shiny, smiley, preclear getting auditing, and there's a dot in the middle of the forehead or whatever, because we had these issues in Africa, producing in Africa, print matter in Africa, I mean, it's almost impossible. So of course we had some issues where the quality was not perfect. There was other issues where we didn't meet the deadline. For some arbitrary reason, the deadline was Thursday at 2 o'clock. Sometimes we would only be able to bring it down to the mail office at 6 o'clock in the afternoon. But there was also a time difference. we could use. Because Thursday, 2 o'clock, what is that? That's something different in Zimbabwe than it is to in US. So somebody, sometimes we would take it Friday instead, and it would be Friday afternoon. I knew that the flight to Europe would not be until Wednesday, so it didn't matter. It didn't matter at all. So just report it out before Thursday, 2 o'clock, everybody would be happy. I would deliver it in maybe a day or 2 days later and still make the plane. So it was like stupid things like that. But I confessed to it as a crime. You know, I lied about the deadline. I accepted a lower quality on some magazines. All these things would so they could frame me for something. And that basically solved the issue for me.
Yeah, but they made you sign a $30,000 US, where you had to repay them for this, what they call an overt product.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
so it's,
yeah.
It's not enough that you confess. They wanted $30,000.
Exactly. Yeah, they wanted money too. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you know, that goes along with their when someone leaves the Sea Org, they want their freeloader bill. So you're an OT5 by this time, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to get your impression, just changing topics off that nightmare business cycle. It's sort of like no good deed goes unpunished. You help save the church an enormous amount of money, and yet you wind up paying them $30,000.
It's ridiculous. Yes. It's true, yeah.
It's a rigged casino. Everything goes in favor of the house in Scientology. So a question... because you're an OT, I often interview many Sea Org members, more so than publics. So you as a Scientology public, when you did OT3 and you opened the course pack and read the story about Xenu and embodied Thetans, what was your impression as a European? Because you're a very rational man, a fine mind. What was your impression?
It was a little hard to digest, but on the other hand, I was impressed by being in the just by actually being present in that courtroom, because it costs money. It takes good deeds and high statistics to get the invitation, and I managed to do that in a matter of a few years. I think I was on OT3 in 88, and that's only 4 years after I started in Scientology. So I basically was much faster than all the rest of the Danish guys and many other Europeans. I mean, there would be people who had been in Scientology for 15 years without getting as far as I had. So I was impressed with being there, impressed with myself. and that was for me a big thing. And also, of course, because the expectations, it's marketed well. I mean, it's marketed like here's something unique, and this is something that could basically kill you if you do it the wrong way. And it's like it's a big mystery thing that's built up about this course room, and there's a bar, iron bar, on inside of the door to barricade, you know. And there's a locks on the there's a big safe, like money safe, where the course packs are kept. And it's like the whole mock-up is like you're really impressed. And at that time, what I must have been 24 years old, so I was a young guy, so I was totally impressed by the whole thing, by the whole theater. And reading that story is like science fiction, and I dug it because it came from Hubbard, and I thought, well, it's like a sci-fi story, basically. I couldn't relate it very much to myself, and yet I could, because then he started talking about the body Thetan, like the demon thing, that if you have strange thoughts, maybe suicidal thoughts, or you're hearing voices, or you're getting, you know, whatever strange inputs, it could be not your own or from your own mind, but from the presence of demons. And that was a creepy thought, that I would actually have demons on me and sitting in my body and so on. It was quite creepy. So that part of that of the thing, I could relate to that and say, well, that's really bad. So the science fiction story about how they came about, I mean, this whole Xeno story is just a sci-fi story about how these demons came about to be there. But it was more like the presence of them, like thinking that here and now, in present time, there might be demons giving me input, you know, different thoughts.
Sure.
strange thoughts, suicidal or aggressive or perverted thoughts or whatever could come from demons sitting on me and I mean on my spirit and in my body. That was a creepy thought. So whether they came by explosion 75 million back or whatever they came from, that's not so important for me. That was just one of Hubbard's many stories. But it was more the thought that they were actually here right now influencing and me.
Sure.
So I got into that mode, that mindset. And from that perspective, OT3 became like quite an adventure.
Well, now that's interesting. Your perspective, here's a couple things that stand out to me. First, you mentioned the whole aura or the context of you have to be invited onto the OT levels, and that's done by virtue of your good deeds and contribution to the church.
Mm-hmm.
Then there's all this high security surrounding it. So you go into a locked room with an iron bar, it's in a bank safe. You're approaching the Holy of the Holies, the secrets of the universe. Now, it never occurred to me that sort of aura can really overwhelm a person. Wow, this is very serious. And I have some friends who are Mormons, and they've some of them have told me the first time they went into the Mormon temple, you know, they had this similar experience of being in the Holy of Holies. Now, what's interesting that Hubbard does on the OT levels, and I'm talking as having done Buddhism for many years, let's use a term psychoactive content. So in human consciousness, whatever it is altogether, there's random psychoactive content moving through. And Zen, you might call it mind weather, like weather moving in and out of your mind. So people get all sorts of random stuff popping in and out of their imagination, their consciousness, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it can be random, outlandish thoughts popping into your mind from nowhere, like where the hell did that thought come from?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, people sometimes when they drive, they get angry, you know, they get cut off and they feel a violent urge.
Mm-hmm.
So the human condition is such is that it can be very erratic at times. You've missed your flight. You're angry. You know you're going to be in trouble because you're going to be late for a business meeting, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Now Hubbard assigns this content to body things. That is, he's saying they are basically channeling the psychoactive input into you that you misown. That is, you identify it as being part of your own activity, when in fact Hubbard's saying it's the activity of body things. So the attempt is to work in auditing to decouple you, the Thetan, from the activity of the BTs by getting them to vanish. That is to blow or depart.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
yep. That's well put.
Yeah, well, thank you. Well, you know, because I'm in my book I'm writing, I'm benchmarking the OT levels against Zen Buddhist traditions and some other traditions.
Mm-hmm.
And having been a spiritual practitioner, I can understand what Hubbard is doing and how the meter's in on it. So I take the Xenu story and I just put it to the side. To me, the Xenu story with body thetans, really, it comes down to this. Hubbard copyrighted everything he did. He was fundamentally a writer who made his living making royalties.
Yes.
Therefore, by having a Xenu story, he has a copyrighted narrative. Body thetans give a birth certificate to otherwise random psychoactive content that arises spontaneously in the human condition. It's unsourced. You know, it's part of the evolutionary function of consciousness in the brain, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, but Hubbard Haskell has a birth certificate, so you have to pay money to go into a Scientology organization and be audited by someone who's certified by the Church of Scientology to audit you. So you, as a public IAS member, go into a building owned by the Church of Scientology International or licensed by it, and you're audited, right? So I see it as a business transaction in which a copyrighted form of space opera is involved. So I can look at it as a businessman, but also from a Zen perspective, or even Carl Jung talked about, he had conversation with what he called the little people.
Mm-hmm.
So basically you're able to localize some or partition off some part of your own activity and consciousness and assign it to a BT. It's more clever and sophisticated than so I don't scoff at it. I look at it as, wait a minute, let's look at what Hubbard's really doing. Because on the outside, it's easy to just simply dismiss as absurd.
Yeah, exactly.
But because I grew up in the Christian church, you know, I was made fun of and mocked. They used to, my friends in high school, some of them would call Jesus a dead guy on a stick and not realizing what the profanity of Christian salvation. So that's sort of the context in which I look at that. Scientology are very serious about what they're doing. But then you become disillusioned, as you write, with the organization, the entire process. You become disillusioned, and how does that disillusionment sink in? What does it feel like?
I think it's recognition that all the things you expected to reach, you don't reach any of it, and in the same time, you cannot talk to anybody about that. Because it's not supposed to be like that. You're supposed to be a superhuman with a supernatural powers and so on. You are not that. But you're supposed to be it. And so I started blaming myself. Say, there's something wrong with my case. Something, you know. It's not the technology that Hubbard developed. It's not the organization. It's not my auditor. It's me. There's something wrong with me. There's something in my case that won't resolve, and so on. And of course, then it becomes difficult to still perform, to play the game, to still be, you know, on the outside, be the successful supernatural person who can solve anything and who can make others change other people's thoughts and do all kind of funny things. And being just a walking success story, I mean, you're supposed to be that. And that became harder and harder to maintain because I knew basically that it was not like that. I had got some I had gotten some wins, some good experiences. I also got a lot of not so good experiences, and I got a lot of auditing that didn't mean anything, didn't change anything, didn't do anything, just like routine. Pick up the cans, do this, do that, say yes, say no, and then go to examiners. Not like any other routine, didn't change anything, didn't do anything for me. But I also had some good sessions where I felt something really happened. But I hadn't become a superhuman, not by any means. So still having to appear like one was like getting harder and harder.
Sure, it's a terrible burden. To have to be to pretend that you're a superhuman with you know unusual abilities spiritually, I remember when I talked to my OT7 friend who was a client who when I was a young man, you know, when I was young I held him in some esteem because he's an OT7 right, and I really didn't know anything about Scientology. But yet he's carrying around that same burden. He told me once that he operated exterior from his body. But I'm looking at him in his eyes, and he's obvious in his body. He said, no, I'm outside of my body. I'm operating it. And it made no sense to me.
Right.
Now, but I can see the pressure you have as a public OT. You have to act like a walking success story and as if you have these abilities. But inside, you're sort of dying, and it's like, I don't want to be a supernatural godlike being because I'm not that. I'm not being honest with myself or others.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And that dishonesty starts eating you up from the inside. I mean, it was, I mean, if you can't be honest about yourself to yourself, then there's no hope. You know, it's like, and that I started feeling more and more. It's also expected that you contribute with a success story now and then. If you hang out with other Scientologists, I mean, you dine with them or whatever, you must have some success stories to tell, how you fix this and fix that. They would expect that. They know that they can't ask you like about exteriorization and OT levels and so on, because that's confidential. So sure. That confidential label helps you. Now and then you can say, well, I can't tell it's confidential.
Oh,
so that can sometimes help you. But they will still expect to hear success stories because, I mean, I paid so much money for this and I spent most of my time on the course room doing courses and getting audits and so on. They expect that I start, you know, getting these successes. So I'd have to come up with stuff and everything that I did, which was a success, would be attributed to my OT levels. I mean, the thing with the post office, the thing with the Zimbabwean post office, that would be because of my OT5. That would be a success, an OT story. I was OT, I was able to influence these people's minds and so on. I mean, it's totally ridiculous, but that's what you have to do in
sure.
order to keep going.
Yeah, it forces you to reinterpret what would otherwise be. So you were very clever as a business person to find a way to save money, okay?
Mm.
And I had that same demand on me in business.
Yeah, yeah.
To be resourceful, to take initiative. And I guess the difference between me as a WOG businessman, as an OT, is I could attribute it to my own ingenuity.
Yeah.
Now, conversely, I made mistakes in business.
Mm-hmm.
And my management let me know about it. They came down hard because corporate life is not forgiving.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't have to do lower conditions.
Right.
You know, I would fix the problem, make sure it didn't happen again, but I wasn't put into lower conditions or punished. I didn't have to pretend to be Superman. And in corporate business, statistics are not expected to increase infinitely forever. We knew there were seasonal fluctuations in business. We knew there were economic things that affected performance. Sometimes we had windfall years where we just blew away our numbers.
Yeah, yeah.
And we got a bonus check for that. It was very handsome. But having to reinterpret your own abilities as an OT, it detracts from you.
Yes. Yeah, you're right.
It detracts from you. So at some point, I'm watching the internet. I've been a critic for a long time. And I remember back when you popped onto the internet. It's like, who's this guy? What's he saying? There was a lot of interest in the Scientology watching community.
Mm-hmm.
And you got you know, and of course the Office of Special Affairs, you came up on their radar.
Yeah, yeah.
Like they were not happy with an OT speaking out saying, you know, this is not what it seems to be.
Yeah, I know.
But when you take that fateful step to depart from the church, you're cutting all ties. I mean, you were mentally and spiritually prepared for it. How hard was it to walk away after being an OT5 and having all your friends and family in your business? How hard was it to rebuild your life?
It was extremely hard. It was extremely hard. I mean, it was like, because at that time I was 40 years old, so I'd been half of my life in Scientology, and that's basically all of my adult life was in Scientology. So I didn't go to university. I didn't do anything. That I went into Scientology instead. I quit being an aspiring musician. I quit music, basically, and changed my values to wanting to become a businessman. That happened in Scientology because they have much more admiration for successful businessmen than they have for non-successful artists. so it was like given that I would change my, it happened quite pretty. I mean, within 3-4 years, I forgotten all about music, and I just wanted to become a successful, rich businessman. And I started wearing a shirt and a tie, and the whole thing changed.
So is it fair to say
what I did when I was young? You know, the rest of you went into university and did other things. I didn't. So all of my adult life was Scientology. So I didn't have any network outside Scientology. I didn't have any education. I had nothing. So it was incredibly hard to quit all that and just start over. You know, being 40 years of age. It's quite some age. I mean, it's nothing compared to now, but it's to start a life from a position where you're 40 years old. That's quite old to start the whole thing, you know. So it was incredibly hard to try to get through that. And I imagine that many would give it a miss. Simply just accept things in Scientology because they cannot see a way through how to start your life all over again in that age, whatever age they might be. I mean, if you were 50 or 60, even worse, I mean, they cannot conceive of any way to start a new life, getting new friends, you know, maybe if a guy is 07, 08, he is something big. But out there in the world, he's nothing. 08, 07, he's nothing.
No, it doesn't
so
mean anything.
So you have to start forcing over again. And that can be, I mean, almost inconceivably hard. So I can understand. And I felt the same thing when we left. Fortunately, I had my wife by my side, and so we left together. And I had a few friends, OTs also, who also left because I've been doing it, you know, the whole research thing together with them. So we were a little core of people who left together. So that helped. But I still had to go out there and find myself a job and you know, make money and new network, new friends, everything.
But, you know, your own resourcefulness. So, it, Robert, it's fair to say that at age 40, Scientology was all you knew.
Yeah,
and
correct.
It can be hard to reinvent yourself. During times in my life where I've had to reinvent myself for whatever reason, there's a verse in the Bible that comes to me from when I was young and studied the Bible, where Jesus says to find your life, you have to lose it. And I think the first serious life crisis I had in my early 20s, that verse came to me to find your life, you must lose it. And it's said the same way in other spiritual traditions. But to be willing to let go of your core sense of identity, of the familiarity to which you're attached, and admit you're ignorant and don't know and you have to start over. It takes a certain amount of humility to say, you know, I have to move on and I really don't know. And I've lost my sense of certainty. Mm-hmm. And I have to reinvent myself even if I'm 40 years old or 50 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So you were very resourceful in that you had your wife to help you. Two are always stronger than one.
Mm-hmm.
So you're fortunate in that way. And more people are leaving as families.
Mm-hmm.
Scientology. And there is strength in family.
There is.
Because family is stronger than the church. Or to put it prosaically, as we in America say, blood is thicker than mud.
Mm-hmm. That's true. Yeah.
And it is true.
And what a nice saying, by the way. To find your life, you have to lose it. What a nice saying.
It's very powerful. It's very powerful in times of spiritual trouble to be able to let go and not know.
Mm-hmm.
But to have the existential courage to go forward. And that's what I saw in your book, the beauty of the human spirit shining through.
Thank you very much, Jeffrey.
Oh, I'm glad you wrote your book. And Robert, as we wind up the interview, I do appreciate your time. There are people who are still in the Church of Scientology. They are under the radar, but they listen to my show. They read the blogs. What would you say to people in the church who want to leave but don't know how to start life over at 40 or 50 or 30? What would you say to them? Robert, as we wind up the interview, I do appreciate your time. There are people who are still in the Church of Scientology. They are under the radar, but they listen to my show. They read the blogs. What would you say to people in the church who want to leave, but don't know how to start life over at 40 or 50 or 30. What would you say to them?
Well, what I would say is that you have to do it because you cannot plan for it anyway. You jump into a new world of where everything is unknown, and it is not a nice thing to do it, and you leave a lot of your life behind. But you cannot wait and plan for it, because things are going to turn out differently than you think anyway. So instead of trying to, I mean, what you can do, you can try to get to prepare your kids, your spouse, whatever, to come with you. That's the only planning you can do. What you're going to do when you get out there, I mean, I wouldn't know, because that's, I like your quote there from the Bible, yes. Finding your life, you have to lose it, because this is incredibly true. You feel this is the right thing to do. Don't wait. Don't wait, because it's going to eat you up. You're going to be weaker and weaker the more you put up with inside the church. So, I mean, the planning you can do is like trying to prepare your close family, maybe some of your friends, but that might go wrong as well, because some might, even your own wife or husband might turn you in, or your own kids might turn you into to OSA or to ethics or whatever. So that might go wrong as well, but that is what I did. I planned with my closest friends, with my wife, and got them into the whole thing, got them to see the truth about what the church really is, and they agreed to leave with me. That was about as much planning as I could do, and then I knew I just had to do it, because just take the jump, get it done, see what happens.
And you did, and it worked out. It wasn't easy, but it worked out. Well, Robert, thank you so much for being on the show. It was wonderful to interview you.
And thank you.
I appreciate your time. And for Surviving Scientology Radio, this is your host, Jeffrey Augustine. Thank you so much for listening. And as always, we'll be in very good touch. Okay, Robert. That was...